Habakkuk chapter 2 verse 1. Habakkuk chapter 2 verse 1 through 4. Today I'm going to preach about vision. This is the beginning of the year, and I like to go into the year with vision. Amen?
Amen.
So Habakkuk chapter 2 verse 1 says, I will stand my watch and set myself on the rampart and watch to see what he will say to me. And I will answer when I am corrected. And the better word there is perhaps instructed. Then the Lord answered me and said, write the vision, make it plain on tablets, that he may run who reads it. For the vision is yet for an appointed time. But at the end it will speak and will not lie. Though it tarries, wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not tarry. Behold the proud, his soul is not upright in him, but the just shall live by his faith. Now, I want to speak about vision. I'm going to speak about four things related to vision. And those four things are, you have to receive it, you have to believe it, you have to declare it, and you have to perform it. And I'm going to go through all four of those as we go on here today. You have to receive it, you have to believe it, you have to declare it, and you have to perform it. Amen. So what is vision? Simply put, a vision is a God-given goal in your life. A God-given goal in your life. A divinely inspired image in your mind of what your future might look like and will look like. Amen. How many of you know vision is important? Vision is important. This week, I was walking in the woods with Heidi in the Rendon State Park area. Excuse me. And there was this tree that fell out down, so I pushed it out of the way. And a twig hit my eye. I don't know how it happened. That's why my eye looks so red. It's better now, but it felt like it was like something in there. I don't think there's anything in it. That's why the eye is red. It got a little blurry at some point, but it's okay now. But you know what? It just reminds you how important vision is. How many of you know vision is important?
Amen.
How many of you know 2020 vision is important?
Amen.
Are we going to have 2020 doubled this year in a sense, because it's 2020 times 2. 2022. Amen.
Amen.
So we're going to have a year of vision in Jesus' name.
Amen.
One of the worst things is to go through life without vision. When you don't have clarity about your future, it's hard. Vision is important. I didn't wear glasses until I was over 40, and only came to me by accident. One day I thought, let me put these on. I was at Dollar Tree, my favorite store. And I put it on, I'm like, wow. I didn't realize how clear it was when I got these. Now this morning, I had this on my head. I'm still getting used to these things. And I was like this.
Yeah.
I could not find my glasses. And finally I got my other glasses. And when I put them on, I felt something bumpy on my head. Actually, one time I was at a restaurant. The same thing happened. I went outside. I went to get my glasses, came in, put them on, and I had two pairs of glasses. One on my head and one on my eyes. It was really funny. And this wonderful family of mine didn't say a thing. You're me with my two pairs of glasses. But let me tell you, my friends, vision is important.
Amen.
And spiritual vision and vision for life is important.
Amen.
Because what does the Bible say? And I don't have that scripture, I can find it for you later. Or just ask Rita, she knows everything in the Bible.
Yeah.
It says, where there is no vision, the people perish. I should have put that in my notes, but it just came to my mind. Where there is no vision, the people perish. Very few things will cause you to stagnate than a lack of vision, a lack of purpose.
Yeah.
It's horrible to live life without purpose. Let me take this off before I forget my glasses on. It's horrible to live life without purpose. Or to think you have purpose but you can't put your finger on it. And to go through life without a goal. If you can't see where you're going, then you're going nowhere. You are living life blindly. But I want to declare today that God is going to infuse you with vision. God is putting vision on the inside of you. I don't know if you're on my side here today because I don't hear no amens, and Heidi's not even here to help me out. Amen.
Amen.
But I believe today that God's going to put vision in your heart.
Amen.
This new year, God's going to spark vision in you.
Amen.
And you will pray and you'll see what the Lord has for you.
Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
You know, I'm everybody's different. But I'm thankful to the Lord that when I was just 13 years old, that I heard the voice of the Lord call me to the ministry. And all my life, I did not have an issue about vision. I knew what I was going to do. I knew what I was going to be. I knew what I was going to live for. Sometimes God would give you a vision later in your life. Like Smith Wigglesworth, the greatest healing evangelist. They call him the father of healing evangelists. He's the guy in England that was a plumber. And for all these years, he was a plumber, and he joined the Salvation Army. And that was his ministry, winning souls with the Salvation Army. And one day, God gave him the healing ministry. And at age 49, I don't think there's one of us here today that's 49. All of us are either 49 or under.
Yeah.
You know, looking at you.
Yeah.
Amen. But at age 49, he entered into the ministry. And God made him the greatest healing evangelist. Praise God. And his books are still all over. Just search his name, Smith Wigglesworth, and do yourself a favor. Read them. You'll be inspired. You'll be blessed. You'll be sent into greater heights with God. But what about Moses? Moses was 80 years old before he went into the ministry. He was 80 years old. Hallelujah. Ben Hinn says, for 40 years, Moses had a BS degree. He was a B somebody. And then, at 40 years till 80 years, he had a BN degree. A B nobody. And then, at age 80, God showed the world what he could do through a nobody. Amen. God will first take you through a season to make you a nobody before he makes you a somebody in Jesus.
Amen.
Because oftentimes our own egos are in the way. God can't use us because we overqualified for God to use us. God has to be very thankful that he's got somebody like me on his side, is what we think. Amen. But God's got a way to humble you, bring you to a place where you realize that you are a nobody without Jesus. And once you get to being a nobody, he says, that's the person I can use. And he raises you up and he makes you not just a somebody, but he's somebody, what he wanted you to be and do. Amen.
Amen.
Let me ask here between us, how many of you have been humbled by the Lord in your life? Amen. You've been humbled. If you haven't yet, perhaps it will happen. Humbled. Humbled. God is, and humility is good. Because the Bible tells us, pride cometh before the fall. A haughty spirit before destruction. There's my Bible, Walking Bible Encyclopedia over there. Amen. But let me tell you something else, my friends. Humility becomes before exaltation. And when God exalts you, he doesn't do it because he wants you to have an ego trip. Oftentimes we think that God's doing it all because of me. No, it's all about His kingdom. Hallelujah. It's all about Jesus. It's all about the Lord. It's all about Him. So a vision is a God-given goal in life. Ask the Lord, Lord, give me a God-given goal. And a divinely inspired image of your future. I don't know if Walt Disney was saved or not, but he was a great visionary. And he built Walt Disney World and Disneyland and whatever. But he died before the place was completed. And at the when they opened Disney World, somebody said to his wife, they said, wouldn't it have been great if Walt could have seen this? And she turned to him and she said, he did. He did. He saw it more clearly in the spirit and in his future than when he saw it in the natural. Hallelujah!
Amen.
Amen. And if you see it in the spiritual and you see it in the vision, in your future, it's just a matter of time. It is going to come to pass. Give the Lord another hand of praise, somebody. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen. God will bring it to pass. God will bring the vision to pass. God is the one who gives you the vision, and He who gives you the vision will bring it to pass. Praise God. I remember Kim Clement. How many of you remember Kim Clement? South African prophet came to the United States, and as he would play, sometimes the Lord would give him a new song. And as they were playing, he played music, you know, he was a great singer. I remember, and then suddenly they went into a role. And he was saying, I'm somewhere in the future, and I look much better than I look right now. I'm somewhere in the future, and I look much better than I look right now. I'm somewhere in the future, and I look much better than I look right now. Come on, everybody, help me wrap out the rap here this morning. One, two, three. Say, I'm somewhere in the future, and I look much better than I look right now. I'm somewhere in the future, and I look much better than I look right now. One more time. I'm somewhere in the future, and I look much better than I look right now. Hallelujah! Let me tell you, start seeing yourself in your future. Look at the future and see yourself as not somebody who is defeated. Not somebody who is, the devil can do with you what he wills. Not somebody that messes around with you and is successful. He is going to mess with you, but he doesn't have to be successful. There's power in agreement. When you agree with the devil, there's power in it. But if you agree with God and say, Lord, your word says, Jeremiah 29 verse 11, I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you, to give you a hope and a future. Amen.
Amen.
Agree with God on that. So anyhow, I don't know if I'm going to get through my 4 points, but man, I worked hard on this message, and I'm going to preach until 3 o'clock, if I have to, if you like it or not.
We're
going to have the heat. I won't be long, amen. But firstly, I have to receive it. Somebody say, I have to receive it.
I have to receive it.
I have to receive it. There's a place of conception of a vision. You have to conceive it. You have to receive it. The word receive in the Latin comes from re capere. And capere means to grasp or to take. So the word receive means to seize. Amen. Somebody say seize. To take hold of. To pick up, to welcome, to accept. And the word grasp means to seize and hold firmly. To seize and hold firmly. That's what we have to do with our vision. We have to seize it and hold onto it firmly. Sometimes God will tell you something, and if you don't receive it, it may be like a seed that gets sown onto cement. It's not going to go anywhere except into a bird's belly. Amen. But you have to receive it. And it will help you if you say, Lord, I'm going to seek you until I hear what you want me to do. You know, not all of us are prophets. And you don't have to be a prophet to hear God's voice. But I can tell you this. If you are really sincere and you are determined that you're going to hear from the Lord what His plan for your future is, He will, capital W, capital I, capital L, capital L, He will show you what He wants for your life. There's no doubt about it. Some of you, God may even speak to you audibly. He's never spoken to me audibly. But if that's what it takes, He'll come and tell you like that. Others, He'll give you a still small voice in your spirit. Others, He will let circumstances just work its way out that way that suddenly you realize I'm where God wants me to be. But what you and I have to do is say, Lord, I will not rest. I will not stop until I've heard what God wants for me. Amen. I remember when I was just, long story made short, I didn't even know what college I was going to go to. And I went and closed the door. And I said, Lord, I will not go out of this door. I will not open this door until I've heard from you which college I should go to. And this was like 3 weeks before college is supposed to receive you in. And you know what? I closed that door. I don't know if I was willing to stay a few days. I won't say I was, but I just knew I'm not going to leave that room until I... But 2.5 hours later, I came out of that place with light in my eyes. And I knew I was supposed to go to Berea Theological College, close to Pretoria in South Africa. The problem is you have to have an interview with a faculty. And I had my interview. I was in the swimming pool of the resort. And a nice looking man, Marius Harold, today's Dr. Marius Harold, told me, I hear you want to become a preacher one day. This is like 3 weeks before college starts. And at that point, I didn't even know where I was supposed to go. He said, and he says, you know, I'm actually on the faculty at Berea Theological College. And we talked, and the more he talked, the more I realized, the more I got excited about it. That's when I went to pray and God confirmed, yes, do it. And so Dr. Marius Harold, who was then not doctor, but he told me, he said, normally you'll have to come in for an interview, but consider I'll talk here in the pool as the interview. Uh-huh. Hallelujah! Yes. Now, when I went to college, I realized they didn't do things like that. It's not some kind of bush place, you know, like whoever comes, you know, it was, they have all kinds of standards. But the Lord made it happen that I could go and I had my interview. I don't think it's anybody who's ever had an interview with a faculty like I was, with no shirt, shorts, and in a pool. And your interviewer from the faculty is also in shorts and his swimsuit and no shirt and in a pool in the hot African sun. Wow. Amen. But let me tell you, God will make a way. But you have to receive it.
Yes.
You have to conceive it in the name of Jesus. Praise God.
Yes.
Hallelujah. So verse 1 says, the Lord answered me. I mean, verse 2 says, the Lord answered me. So why did the Bible say the Lord answered me? Because of verse 1. It says, I will stand my watch and set myself on the rampart and watch to see what He will say to me. Do you want to hear the voice of the Lord? Yes. You've got to go out of your way and go watch to see what He will say unto you. Yes. If you have the attitude like, oh well, whatever God wants to speak to me, He'll tell me. I don't have to go ask Him. You might never hear from Him. But if you go like Habakkuk, and you say, I will stand on my watch and I will see what He shall say unto me. When you make a determination that you're going to see it, you're going to insist on it, You're going to insist that you want to hear from the Lord. You want a vision from Him.
Yes.
That's when it happens. You have to receive it. Amen. Number two, you have to believe it. Now, I don't know this, but the word believe, the word be in believe is basically to be in a state of, or take part of an action of, but the word leave is related to the word love, and it's beloved, or believe. The word believe means to care, desire, or love. How many of you know we need to be, to fall in love with God's vision for our lives? You shouldn't make your vision your God, because I've seen that too, when people make their vision their God. Their whole life is about their vision. All about me, what I'm going to be one day, what I'm going to do. Now, there's a place in your season, in your life, where God lets you do that, because we've got to be in love with our vision, but not more in love with God. You know, if I gave Heidi, when we got married, and I, you know, just gave her gifts, and she just loved those gifts, I said, hey, what about me? Amen. You don't love the gifts more than the giver. And so it is with the Lord. He's the giver of the vision. But don't fall in love with your vision more than you fall in love with God. But since God gave you the vision, beloved your vision. Believe your vision. Believe your vision in the name of Jesus. You have to receive it, and then you have to believe it. Because the Bible tells us that a man who is full of doubt will not receive anything from the Lord. Somebody say, no doubt.
No doubt.
Only believe.
Only believe.
Only believe. Don't let, when God shows you something, don't doubt it. And if the doubts come, good. Deal with it. Dominate your doubts with your faith. Amen. Turn to your neighbor and say, dominate your doubts with your faith. Say it one more time.
Dominate
your doubts with your faith. Amen. Don't let your doubts get the better of you. Hallelujah. Hebrews 11 verse 1 says, now faith, or believe, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Ooh, hallelujah. The evidence of things not seen. You know, when the Bible says evidence of things not seen, it means there's certain things that you cannot see in the natural. But as sure as you're sitting here and I'm standing here, or as sure as the old prophet says, as sure as the Lord thy God liveth, I know that that which I cannot see is real. And God showed me something in the future, and I look much better than I look right now. God's given you something. He's given you a vision. He's given you a plan for your life. Receive it and believe it. Be convinced of its reality. I don't know if this is a good illustration or not, but Mike Truett, married to the Boardwalk Plaza Hotel's daughter, who runs it now or something. But anyhow, Mike Truett, you know the Truetts, right? Bud Truett, who used to be at Bethel Tabernacle, old Pastor Bud Truett. Well, his son, Mike Truett, I heard him preach once on a tape, actually, but he preached out there in Joppa, Maryland. And he talked about how, you know, he was away from the Lord. And he says at one point he checked himself into, he called it a nut house. So he checked himself in. Now, so anyhow, he did that. But it took him just a couple of days to realize that he doesn't belong there. How did he know that he doesn't belong there? He said he went to the rec room. How many of you know what a rec room is? That's where they have fun, whatever. And he says there were two guys in a heated argument. They were playing pool. And the one apparently had moved the ball. And the other one told him, don't move my ball again. You moved my ball. And the other one said, I did not move your ball. And if you say that again, I'm going to take this pool stick and hit you. Now that could happen in any bar, but the difference is in the, what he calls the nut house, is there was no pool table. There was no balls. There was no pool sticks. But those two guys, was a heated argument that the guy really had moved his ball. And that's when he realized, I'm not that nuts. I don't need to be here. And he checked himself out. Now, like I said, it's probably not the best illustration, but let me tell you what. I want to be a nut for Jesus. Because God has shown me something that others cannot see. I've seen my future. I've seen my destiny. I've seen my vision for God's life. And you will see your vision. If you have not yet, I speak it to your mind. I speak it to your life. I declare it over you. You will have clear vision. And you will see what God wants for your life. And when other people don't see it, you say, it doesn't matter, because faith is the substance of the things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. I've got evidence that what I don't see is real. It's in my faith. Hallelujah!
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 Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Yes, amen.
Listen to this. Faith is to be convinced of the reality of something without the aid of external senses, but by internal perception only. I have to say that again because people are writing notes here. I'll say it two more times for you. Just, it says, what I wrote here, faith is to be convinced of the reality of something without the aid of external senses, but by internal perception only. Turn to your neighbor and say, you must have a good place to shout amen.
Amen.
Some things you cannot see with the external senses, but as sure as the Lord liveth, on the inside of you, you've seen it with your spirit, and it is as real as anything. I want to read to you from the Amplified Bible. This is really great. It says, now faith is the assurance, the title deed, confirmation of things hoped for, divinely guaranteed, the evidence of things not seen, the conviction of their reality. Faith comprehends as fact what cannot be experienced by the physical senses. I'm going to read that last part for you again. Faith is the evidence of things not seen. Faith is the conviction of their reality. Faith comprehends as fact. Somebody say that. Faith comprehends as fact.
Faith comprehends as fact.
What cannot be experienced by the physical senses. Amen. God did that for Abraham. He went out. God said, come out, I want to show you something. He went out of his tent and he showed him the stars. And he looked and God said, so shall all your seed be. And for years he didn't have one child. But whenever doubt came, he always closed his eyes and looked and remembered when he saw the stars. And then he danced with the stars. And he said, I don't have a child yet, but as sure as the Lord liveth, I've seen the stars. I've seen my future. And God made him the father of a multitude of nations. Okay, that's all. So we touched on receive it, believe it. What's the next one?
Declare it.
Did you just say cheat on it?
Achieve it.
Okay. All right. Achieve it. That's a good one. We'll actually get to the next. That's part of the following one. But declare it. So the word declare, see that word clear in declare? It comes from the word clarify in the Latin. Clara. So, declare means to clarify totally. The word D in declare means down to the bottom or totally. And clear, from the Latin clare or clara, is to clarify. So, you totally clarify by speaking it forth. The dictionary says that declare means to say something in a strong and confident way. to say something in a strong and confident way. So put your faith where your mouth is, and put your mouth where your faith is. Start declaring it. Start speaking it. Start saying, I will live and not die. Start saying, I will be prosperous, not poor. Start speaking it. I will be successful, not... What's the opposite of successful?
Unsuccessful.
Man, I got smart people in this church. Smarter than their pastor. Amen. Somebody say, I will be successful. I'll be prosperous. I'll be healthy. And I will fulfill God's plan for my life.
Amen.
What does the Bible tell us? And I, for some reason, I did write it down. No, I didn't. Did I not? Yeah, I did. Proverbs 18, verse 21. Death and life are in the power of the
tongue.
Death and life are in the power of the tongue. And he and they that love it will eat the fruit thereof. So death and life are in the power of the tongue. So if you speak death, what do you get? Death. Defeat. But if you speak life, what do you get? Life. Victory. Power. Success. Vision. Prosperity. Now Heidi, she's big on this. I mean, I am too. I read a book when I was like 14 years old, and Afrikaans said it. What you say is what you crave, by Don Dezet Gazette.
Yeah.
English is, say it. What you say is what you get. Years later, I thought, you know what? I wonder if he's still alive. I found him. I got to talk to him for over an hour. And I told him what a blessing he was when I was like 14, 15, something like that. But it taught me to put my mouth into the right direction. I do not speak defeat. Let me tell you what, I've got a lot of faults, I guess. Not to me I know of. I'm kidding. But whatever my faults may be, I'm not a defeatist speaker. I don't speak defeat. Amen, I speak faith. And I'm so glad I've got Heidi on the bandwagon with me. She only speaks life. Sometimes whenever our kids were raised and they would be negative or something, Heidi would say, are you speaking life? And they would speak life. Toby Mac, he sings that song, speak life, speak life. You know? Now it's pretty interesting when your kids start preaching back to you. One day Heidi, I forget what it was, but she said something and Timothy was like, Mommy, are you speaking life? Amen. That's good. Are you speaking life? Speak life, because death and life are in the power of the tongue. Speak, not necessarily even positive, speak the word. Because positive can mean anything, but the word means everything. I want to read to you from Mark chapter 11. Got Mark here with us today, he wrote it all by himself. Thank you, Mark. So honored to have you, St. Mark, with us here this morning. Mark chapter 11, verse 22. Jesus answered and said to them, have faith in God. Now watch this. For assuredly I say unto you, whoever, look at this word, says to this mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that those things which he says, see that word says, will be done, he will have whatsoever he says. So you have it three times. Jesus showed us the power of your words. If you say to this mountain, be removed, be cast in the sea, and you don't doubt in your heart, that whatsoever you say shall come to pass, you shall have whatsoever you
say.
Say. Amen. So say it. Speak life in the name of Jesus. Let's give the Lord a hand of praise. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And now we'll close with the last one. You said, achieve it. That's actually good. Declare it, achieve it. I wrote, perform it. I like the word achieve. It means the same thing, actually. But perform it. Perform it. The word perform means to put form to it. Amen. You take something that was all mangled, and you put form to it. And how did God do it? The Bible says in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and the earth was formless and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of the Lord moved upon the waters. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. And God took a mess of confusion and he performed the vision he had in his own mind. God had a vision. God knew in his mind what he wanted. And how he manifested it, he spoke it. And he made the beautiful heavens and the earth. So, James chapter 2 verse 26 says, faith without works is dead. Now, normally we understand that as our moral works, and of course we should, because if you say I've got faith but you live like the devil, I'm sorry, you're not really having faith. Faith without works is dead. There are people like that. They say, well, you know, I'm a Christian, and then they live like the devil. If you're a real Christian, you're not going to live like the devil. Amen. But it applies to moral works, but it also applies to corresponding actions with your faith. James 2:26, it says, faith without works is dead. So do you believe it, what God wants to do in your life?
Yes.
Well, go put action to it. Because your faith, your vision, without action, is dead. Amen. It's dead. You can speak all kinds of things like I'm going to do this and that and the other. If you don't put action to it, it's going to be dead. It's going nowhere. It's D-A-I. It's a dead, D-O-I. Dead on arrival. D-A-I. How do they say it? One of those. Dead on arrival. You know? My brothers and sisters, I believe here today, there are people who say, I'm going to achieve it.
Yeah.
I'm going to perform it. Why? Because I've got God on my side. The Good News Translation says, so then as the body without the spirit is dead, so also faith without actions are dead. An action means to carry out, to accomplish, to fulfill an action, task, or function. The word perform means to discharge, execute, and transact, to carry to completion a prescribed course of action. Now that's actually good. I'm going to read that again. To perform, to discharge, and execute, and transact, and carry out to completion a prescribed course of action. Hallelujah. If you want to go to a certain college, do something that leads you towards that college. Write letters. Contact people. You might not know people in high places, but you don't know how far a letter might go. And you might know somebody who knows somebody in high places. Amen. Whew. Okay, so let me close here, but look at this, Romans 4 verse 20 to 21, and I told you I've got 4 points, but I'm going to give you 5, the bonus, amen, just for a little extra offering here today, I'll give you a bonus, I'm kidding, but I'll give you the bonus, but first, before I give you the bonus, Romans 4 verse 20 to 21, talking about Abraham. Abraham did not waver at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strengthened in faith, giving glory to God, and being fully convinced that he who promised was also able to perform. I like that. Somebody say after me, the God who promised is well able to perform what he promised. Now give the Lord another hand of praise, somebody.
Hallelujah!
So here's the bonus. The tag on number 5, and this is for free, by the way. Everything is for free. But you got to wait for it. Because what did we read? The Bible says, we read that in Habakkuk. It says, write the vision. And everything I said to you today, you can go there and see everything corresponds. Write the vision. Make it plain upon tablets, that he may run. Action, who readeth it? You know, who's conceived it, and who readeth it? And it said, though it tarry, Sometimes your vision won't come to pass that same month, that same year, sometimes 10 years, sometimes longer. The vision does not come to pass. But though it tarry, wait for it. Why? For it will surely come to pass. In the end, it will not lie. It will surely come. Is that in your Bibles? It's in my Bible. But the point I want to read right now is the one that says, though it tarry, wait for it. Now, one of the things I didn't like to do is wait. You need a lot of patience to wait. I'm a driven man. You know what it's like to be driven? Willis, I can see it in you. You like to just go get things done. Amen. You want to get things done. And that's how I was. But one day, God made Adam and Adam. And Adam was that same kind of man. He was driven. He was going to do what God told him to do, everything. And then what God did? He gave him Eve. And God spoke to him and said, from now on, thou shalt wait every time you want to go somewhere. How many of you know what I'm talking about? I was a driven man, and I'm still a driven man. But let me tell you what, when I got married to Heidi, everything slowed down. Heidi, what now? Oh, she's still doing her hair. I'm glad she's not here. We'll edit the video tape later on. She's doing her hair, putting her makeup on. And I'm sitting there waiting. Okay, I'll wait in the car. At some point I thought, if you sit in the car, you're going to give her the idea. You're ready to go. You wait in the car. And finally she comes. But man, when she did come, I was glad. She looked so beautiful. But in God's sense, waiting is not just waiting. You know what waiting means in God's way? Somebody say it after me. Staying power.
Staying power.
God wants to give you the ability that when the vision doesn't come to pass for a while, that you have staying power. Staying power. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Staying power. The word staying power means the ability to maintain an activity or commitment despite fatigue or difficulty. The ability to maintain an activity or commitment despite fatigue or difficulty. How many of you just got tired sometimes in your life? You know, your life stamina just disappears. But God's going to give you stamina. God's going to give you staying power. God's going to give you the ability to maintain an activity or commitment despite fatigue and difficulty. It's the capacity of continuing as in existence, influence, and popularity without weakening. You're not going to weaken. You know what God told you. You're going to hang in there. It's to actively press toward the goal, then not budge or retreat in the face of adversity when your vision gets challenged. I'll read that one more time. Staying power means to wait on God, of course. Staying power, to actively press towards the goal and not budge or retreat in the face of adversity or when the vision gets challenged. I can tell you now, my friends, I've preached myself hard. Hallelujah. We're done in here. You're good, right?
I'm good.
Amen. Let me tell you what. If your vision is never challenged, it's probably not a vision worthwhile. But I just told you to speak. And I wasn't shouting it. Amen. But what I just told you is big. If your vision does not get challenged, it's probably not worth much. But if your vision scares the devil and the devil starts fighting your vision, rejoice. And I'm not sure you're supposed to thank the devil, but maybe just say, thank you, devil. Thank you for fighting my vision. Because it shows me that you're scared of it. It shows me that I have a vision worthwhile fighting. Because if you didn't fight it, that would have meant that my vision wasn't worth much. But thank you, devil, that you're fighting my vision. because that shows me it scares you. It shows me God gave it. It shows me it's going to do something. It shows me that it's going to shake my generation. It shows me it's going to shake my city. It shows me it's going to shake my family in the name of Jesus.
Yes, amen.
Don't you think that we should shake our family? Hallelujah. I heard Paula White. Have you ever heard preachers like Bill Johnson out in Bethel? Fifth generation preacher. That's amazing to me. Daniel Kalenda, who's got Reinhard Bonnke's ministry that he took over, great brother, friend of mine. Fifth generation preacher. How many of you know Paula White? She says she's a sixth generation heathen. But God came into the sixth generation heathen's life and God did a mighty work in her life. How many, you just have to listen to her preach and you'll know God did a mighty work in Paula White's life. So much so that she became president. She lived in the Trump Towers before Trump was president. And then God eventually used her to speak into him and Melania's life. And was his spiritual advisor. That's not too bad for a sixth generation heathen. Amen. Here's my point. God can use you to change your family tree. You may come from a long line of liars, deceivers,
drunkards,
drug addicts, and everything. But somebody say after me, it stops with me.
With me.
And I'm going to change my family tree.
Okay,
amen.
Yes.
I am so blessed. I've got in-laws that they don't drink. How that happened? You like this, Mark? I don't know why you'd like it, but keep you engaged in my message. I'm going longer than I should now, but I'll end you soon. I already told you I was closing with this 20 minutes ago, right? But let me just, they lived in this area, and they were social drinkers. They weren't drunkards, but they were social drinkers. They drink their wine, their brandy, whatever it was. And one day they got saved. And when they got saved, Ronnie, Opa, your grandfather, he says, we can't have this in our house anymore. So he wants to pour it down the toilet. And Mom, she agrees, we don't want drink in our house anymore. So she says, well, let's give it to somebody. I mean, that costs a lot of money. But Dad was like, we're not giving this curse to nobody. Yes, instead of going down the toilet, they went and poured it outside. Poured all the alcohol out. I don't know if it was $100 or $500. How many of you alcohol is expensive? Mm-hmm. How many of you like to have all the money back that you spend on alcohol? Man, you'd be a rich person.
I'd give it to you for your church.
There we go. That's 400,000. Amen. But listen to this. The next day, Canuck was drunk. Who's Canuck? Their great Dane. They saw there was something wrong with Canuck. He just couldn't walk right. I'm glad Bunny wasn't around in those days. But that's how they got rid of it. My brother-in-law doesn't drink. My sister-in-law doesn't drink. My wife doesn't drink. Amen. I don't drink. Praise God. And I declare of my children, they will not drink.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Why? Because we change our family tree.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Well, I don't know how we got to that point, but that was good. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for the word that we preach you this morning. And God, we go into 2022 with vision. And those who do not have vision, they go into 2022 with a vision to receive vision. Make it your vision. I feel God's telling somebody, make it your vision to get vision. Let getting vision be your vision. Don't do everything else. Get vision. Let getting vision be your vision. And then of course we know the vision will be accomplished. But some of us just have to start at the bottom floor here. Just get vision to get vision. Even if you don't have vision to have vision. In the name of Jesus. And Father, I want to just speak over your people today. Your word says, speak life. So I'm going to do that because there may be a fogginess in some people's brains. A fogginess in our minds. A fogginess of God's plan. I know, I've gone through that. I've felt it and still do at times. And then I have to fight through it till I get the clarity of what God has for me. So today, I speak that over God's people. And I declare, in the name of Jesus, the sun shines over the mist and the fog that's in your mind and evaporates it, and God gives you clear vision in Jesus' name. And if you agree with that, shout hallelujah! Say, I receive it!
I receive vision!
I'm not just hanging around! I will do what God has for me.
I will do what God has for me.
I will be what God wants me to be.
I will be what God wants me to be.
I will accomplish what God wants me to accomplish.
I will accomplish what God wants me to
accomplish. I'm a man or a woman of vision.
I'm a woman of vision.
In Jesus' name. Now let's give God another big hand of praise. Woo! Hallelujah!
Hallelujah!